about Drupal. This is going to be about PHP. Okay? It's not something which is very specific to Drupal. Whatever I'm going to be talking today, you'll be able to apply it for any project which uses PHP. Right? Okay. Now that I've told about myself, you know, you guys can probably talk about yourself. Let me know, like, you know, at least let me know about these things. So I'm assuming that all of you are PHP developers. Is that correct?
Yes.
Any non-PHP developer here? Have you used PHP before?
Yes.
Okay, then I think you can call yourself as a PHP developer. And what is your typical dev environment look like? You guys use NetBeans, you guys use PHP Storm. What is your
NetBeans.
PHP Storm.
Sublime.
Any Vim fan here? Eclipse. Anybody who uses Vim apart from me? Great.
No,
Vim. Emacs. Okay. Let's not look at each other directly. And how long have you guys been working on PHP? Let's probably like split it into different buckets, right? Less than 5 years. Okay. 5 to 10 years. Okay. More than 10 years. That means I'm very old. Okay. So let's get to the last point. So what is your expectation out of this talk? What do you guys want to learn? I mean, to be frank, I have no idea. I'm not that much. It's going to be mostly about PHP. Yes. Okay. So, alright. So, let's go to the next question, right? So, how many of you have done unit testing before? Not necessarily in PHP, but like anywhere. Have you done unit testing before? Manual testing. 1, 2, 3, 4. You guys did it in PHP? PHP? Okay, Lara. Okay. Then you may probably be able to help me today. Okay, so let's get started, right? So since most of us have not done unit testing before, we'll probably like, you know, for the first couple of slides, we'll try to motivate ourselves why we should do unit testing, right? To get started, this is a piece of PHP code, right? Can you find, is there any issue in this code? Is there any bug? What happens if I run it in my production system, which has like, let's say, millions and millions of users and things like that, right? Is there any bug which you can find in this code?
Yes.
Okay, I will get back to you because you already done unit testing. Anybody else? Okay, I have a question for you. How many bugs did you find? Anybody else? Are you guys able to find anything wrong in this code? So basically, we have a class, right? We have a couple of methods, and then we are creating an instance of the class, and then we start calling those methods. Okay, so you found the bug, right? Can you tell me what is the bug here?
The constructor is not getting passed.
Sorry?
The return value is not passed.
Okay, so maybe like I should probably go closer and tell you what is exactly wrong. So we are creating a object. So this is a class, right? It has two methods. We are creating an object of the class. And then invoke the execute method. Right? Now, what happens is the execute method gets invoked. Right? And here, this is going to check for this value. Is this value already set?
No.
Because this method is not called. write a code, it is very difficult for you to find out what are the possible ways by which this code can fail. Right? If you are a developer of that particular code, then you can probably at least think of certain scenarios where in which it will fail. But even then, there might be like a lot of scenarios where it might fail which you have not envisioned before. Right? So the main takeaway is finding bugs in code is very, very difficult. Right? So what is the solution for it? People just say write tests. Right? But all of us know that sounds obvious, but getting started or getting to write test cases is very difficult. Right? The typical reason being, in any project where you are going to be writing unit test cases, if you compare the number of lines of the code and the number of lines you have for the unit test cases, it will be typically 4 or 5 times. Right? So from a project manager's perspective, it is like writing 5 times more code. So you probably going to be saying you are wasting a lot of time. Or even from a developer's perspective, he's probably going to be thinking that instead of writing like say 10 lines of code, I'm going to be writing 50 lines of code. So am I wasting time? Right? But it's been like proven more than once that if you write test cases, if you do unit testing, the amount of time you're going to be saving at the end of the day when you're maintaining your code is going to be huge. Right? So that's again one motivation for you to start considering unit test cases. So, as probably like most of you know, there are different ways or different types of testing you can do, like functional testing, integration testing, unit testing, and things like that. So, unit testing is like at the base. It starts with testing one particular unit of your code or of your project, right? After that, you would be doing integration testing where you have all these different units test independently, and then you try to test all of them combined together, or when what happens when you integrate it. That is the integration testing you do. And on top of that, you do the functionality testing. So from a functionality testing perspective, the code is black box. You don't really care whether that particular module is unit tested or not. You're just going to test whether whatever functionality you need is being there or not. So the confidence in your system or the confidence in your project would go up as you go above, right? So once you have done unit testing, you would have some amount of confidence, and then once you do integration testing, you will probably have like more confidence and things like that, okay? And in this talk, we are going to be talking about only unit testing, right? I think most of you who are working on projects, I think would have probably be already doing functionality testing. Is there anybody who does not do any functionality testing on your projects? Any production projects? No, because you would be testing, right? So so what we would be covering today is mostly unit testing, right? Okay. So briefly, I'm not going to be talking about what is PHPUnit, how do you install it, how do you activate it, and things like that. For a simple reason, if you go to do any web search, that's going to be the first link, and then you will be able to do it in like 5 minutes. Right? There's no point you sitting here for a talk and then me talking about it when you can find it in a simple web search. Okay? So briefly, I'm just going to say what is PHPUnit. So PHPUnit is a framework. It's part of a family of frameworks called unit testing frameworks. There are frameworks for different languages. Like Java has JUnit and like things like that. So for PHP, we have something called PHPUnit. It's a unit testing framework which allows you to unit test your PHP code. Okay? And I'm not going to be talking about installing PHPUnit. You can basically like do a web search. Basically, it involves like using Composer to install it. How many of you are using Composer? Since all of you are PHP developers. Okay, so the people who are not using Composer, first, try to use Composer. Second, basically it's a package manager, right? It allows you to make sure that you don't have, if you have dependencies on your project or if your project depends on certain modules or libraries, it makes it very easy for you to retrieve them. Okay, so those who are not using Composer, try to use Composer for your PHP code. Okay, and we also talk about slightly about how do you set your folder structure. And finally, about the PHP unit XML file. So this XML file is a config file which basically you give for PHP unit so that it understands where are your source code, where are your test cases, which file it should execute, and things like that. Okay. So let me quickly show you the folder structure. guys are able to see my screen, right? Do you want me to increase the font size a bit?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is this fine? Probably go one more. Okay. So if you take any PHP project, right? So this is the typical folder structure which people follow. So your PHP unit or XML file, which is your configuration file for PHP unit, right? So that goes on the root directory. And then you have two directories at the root. One is the source folder where all your source files go in. And then you also have your test folder where all your test files are going to be going in. And inside the test file, test folder, we have the unit test folder where you're going to have all our unit test cases. You can also have other things like functional test and things like that on that, on inside the test folder. And let me quickly also show you the PHP unit XML file. So this is basically the configuration file which you use for specifying how to, basically like you would be specifying what is your source directory, what is your test directory and things like that. And there are also like a lot of additional things where you can basically like specify where should your, you know, what are the different PHP configurations you need for your test cases. For instance, do you want to display error, things like that. All these are the PHP INI settings for PHP unit. Okay, so you can override them. If you're not overriding here, it would read from your php.ini. Let's get back to our presentation. So one important thing when we get into PHP unit is that you should know what to test, right? So when you say unit testing, you shouldn't be like not trying to test each individual method, because you would get maximum out of it, or you would be getting the maximum value out of unit testing when you actually know what to test. So basically you should test your functionality, not individual methods. So basically when you say unit testing, right, so people have the assumption that it is testing a single unit. So you end up testing your methods, but try to test your classes, not your methods. Okay? Because even going back to the first example which I showed you, right, if you are writing just unit test cases for the methods, where is that? It's here. So if you are just going return unit test cases just for the methods, each individual method separately, then this test case would have passed, right? You wouldn't have found what was the issue which was there in this code. But when you write test cases for the entire class, that's when you would have found that there is a dependency on the initialize method inside the execute method, and those things should be called in some order, and the value should be initialized and things like that. Okay. So the main, so the main takeaway is, make sure you test the functionality or test your classes, not individual methods. And the other thing is, when you talk about a class, you basically would have two different types of members, right? One is your public members and the other one are private. So public members could be your methods, your variables, private again your methods, your variables and things like that. When you're doing unit testing, make sure you test the public interface of your class, right? There is no point testing your private method if your private method is not going to be called by any method which is outside your class, right? So make sure you test your public interface. Also, if you go back to the object-oriented principle, anything which is inside, right? Anything which is private can change, and those classes or those methods which are consuming your class need not know that your private implementation has changed. They should not depend on your private implementation. Right? That's one of the core principles of object-oriented programming. And the other important thing is, don't test your getters and setters. Right? If you have like a lot of getters and setters, don't keep writing test cases for them. Unless and until there is one exception to this rule, in which case is when you have custom validation on your setup. Right? So let's say you have a setup for your class, but you are doing a lot of custom validations on it, then in that case you should test those custom validations, but don't test like your plain getters and setters. So the point is, you're not going to get any value out of it, right? Always like unit testing always follows the 80-20 rule. So basically you you have to, like, you know, create instances of class, or if you have some dependencies which you have to create, all those things would be done in the setup phase. Okay? After that, you have the act phase, where you would basically be doing whatever action you are going to be validating for that particular test case. Right? So first you set up everything, then you act upon it, or you basically invoke whatever functionality you are going to be testing. If it's like, you know, for instance, you are testing the return value of a method. So invoking that method would come in your act phase. Okay? Now the third phase is the verify phase, where in which you would basically be comparing the value, whatever value you got, with the expected, right? With the expected value. So there would be a comparison between your actual value and expected value that happens in your verify phase. Okay? So these three steps are important for any test case. So let's see some demo. So there is no point in me just like giving or just talking about these pieces without you actually seeing something. So this is the class which I initially showed you, right? So we would try to find what are the issues with it. Or basically, like, we would try to document this class. So one other way by which you can think of unit testing is documenting. Right? If you are a developer of a class and you need to let another developer know how he should consume your class. One way is to write huge documentation telling him, like, you know, this is how each method works, you should, like, properly call this method before this and things like that. Or you can write unit test cases. The benefit of doing unit test cases is you are validating your code. At the same time, anybody who is going to be consuming your class would have a reference of how to use your class. Okay? So you can probably do that. So that's what we're going to do now. So basically, we have this very simple class. We have two methods and one protected value. And we are going to be testing this. Okay. As a developer of this class, we are assuming that one of the first things which we are going to be assuming is that the execute method should be called after the initialize method is called. If it is not, if. So that would be like the first test case which we would be testing. So this is the test case for that particular sample file. Again, PHP unit expects you to do certain things. For instance, here you can see that I'm extending the PHP framework test case class. Okay? Again, this is some documentation which you'll be able to find out if you just do a web search on PHP unit. The very first example you're going to get about PHP unit would talk about this. So I'm not going to get into much detail on that. So basically, the idea is whatever class you have, you would be extending the test case or the PHP unit framework test case class. Okay? Once you do that, you whatever every method you write would be a unique test case for your functionality. And here, I'm basically like including my sample file which I want to do the testing for, and I'm going to be writing test cases. Right? So here is the first test case. So this is the setup phase which I talked about. Basically what I'm doing, I'm creating a new instance of my sample class which I want to test. Next is the act phase. In the act phase, what I'm doing, first I'm calling the initialize method, then passing some value to it. Next, I'm going to be calling the execute method and then get the return value. So basically this is the action or this is the functionality which I want to test. Right, so I'm doing that. And third is where we do the verify. Again, PHP unit has a lot of methods, inbuilt methods, which allow you to do these assertions or these verifications, right? So assert equals is another method which allows you to do that. Basically, it takes two parameters. One is the expected value and the other one is the actual value. And then it would compare it and then let you know whether the test case has passed or failed. In this case, we pass 10, so we should get the return value should be 100, and that is what we are doing here. So let's run PHP unit on this. So getting back here, I have the PHP unit.xml file on my root of the project. So all I need to do is just run PHP unit, and then it will read the configuration file automatically, and then we'll run the test case. So basically, here it says that there is one test case. There is one test case and then there was one assertion in that test case and it has passed. Right? So for instance, if I had made, instead of, let's say, 100, I had 101. So when I run this, it would say that this is a failure. And it would tell me, like, which out of these test cases, which one failed. It will also tell me, like, which test case failed, right? So here, this is the test case that failed. Test executed with, works with initially. That is the name of the test case, and it's telling me that that has failed. So let's go back, let's correct this. And when we run it again, it should pass. Now, we will go on and add other additional test cases, right? So if you go back to the source code again, one other thing which we need to test is whether the exception would be thrown if I call the execute method directly, right? So let's write a test case for that. So I've already returned it, so I don't have to type it again. Let's do this. So basically here, in the setup case, what I'm going to do, I'm going to be initializing the class, right? I've created an object of the class. And in the add phase, I'm just calling that execute method without calling the initialize method. Right? So now what it should do? It should throw an exception. And throwing an exception, because if you're compiling a value, return value, then you can use other equals or any of the other functions to validate or to verify. But if it is going to be throwing an exception, and the expected behavior is that it throws an exception, what you need to do is basically add this block in the dot. Basically you expect an expectation for this test class. If the exception is thrown, then your test case will pass. If not, it will fail. Okay? Then you can also specify the type of exception that will be thrown. If you look at the source code, we said we'll just throw an exception, but if you're using a custom exception, right? If you have your own subclass, you have created your own subclass of exception and you're throwing that, then we can check for that. But in this case, we're just throwing an exception. And we can check that here. Right? So this is the second test case that we have written. And run PHP unit again. So now it says that we had two test cases. And both of them have passed, right? So for instance, if I have not specified this, now it throws an exception and it will result in an error. So let's get back to the presentation. So this is the first test case which we wrote, right? So basically we have a setup phase, the act phase, and the verify phase. Right? And then this is how you do the testing of exceptions. So basically you have to add that doc block for that method, for the test case method, so that it knows that if an exception is thrown, then it passes. Right? So I'll stop here. Any questions so far? Any clarification? The name of this function, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so generally what we so basically the name of this function would appear if the test case is failed. Right? So what you generally try to do is try to make it readable enough so that when you look at the name of the function, you know what functionality is being tested. So that when you see that this test case is failed, you know what has failed. That is the general convention which people follow. And the other thing is, they would always prefix it with test underscore. It's not mandatory, but it's like a recommended or best practice to do that. Okay. Any other question before we
continue?
XML file.
Yes.
So this is the config file for the unit. And the main important part here, I would say, is the test this configuration.
It basically says that, you know, which directory you should look for and what file you should look for. Those are the tests. So PHP unit should know that. And you can also like have other things. You can basically like create groups have like a huge number of modules and you don't want to run all the test cases when you modify something, you can create groups and then invoke movie tasks. That is something which you can do. And also, like,
this is something which I talked about.
So you basically can set specific PHP and settings here for your test cases or not. So if you don't set anything, by default, it's read from your php.ini file. It's a command line. So it will read from your CLI script. If you have specified here, this will override. So this is a test case which we have for comparing negative values, right? So we have tested positive value. Let's see what happens when we pass negative values. So the same thing, we have created the sample. So we have created the object in the setup phase, and we have the act case where we call the method, and here we are passing a negative value, and we are also having the verify phase where we are asserting that the value or the both, or basically we are comparing the expected value and the actual value. Right? So let's quickly run this. Yeah, it is passing. So we have three test cases now and three assertions. Both of them are, or all three of them are passing. Now we can, like, as I said, we can continue doing for decimals. So again, what happens if you use a float? Right? So in the integer multiplication and float multiplication. Are there any issues with that? That is something which we can again test. So this case is, this test case is again very simple or very similar. The only difference is like we are using a decimal value and then you are passing the same value here, right?
So let's test it again. So this is also passing,
right?
Now, let's go back to this code again.
Can you tell me what happens if we pass 0? What will happen if we initialize it with 0? Would it, so I have two answers. Someone is saying I'll get 0, someone is saying I'll get an exception. So you guys, so how many of you believe that it will return 0? Or okay, I'll say how many of you believe that you would expect an exception? So you believe that it will throw an exception. How many of you believe it will return 0? Okay. Let's find out what is the correct thing, right? So we are assuming that it will return 0, right? Let's execute this. It's actually failing. It is throwing an exception. So if you look at it, so the reason why it is failing is because when you have 0 on line number 10, when you are compiling, right, PHP does something called when you have boolean and number, it treats 0 as false. Right? So when you have 0, it is treating that 0 as false, and so because of that the condition in line number 10 would be true, and so it throws an exception. Right? So the reason why I put that here is, if you have just looked at the code, it is extremely difficult, even for somebody who is like probably a PHP expert, it will be extremely difficult for him to assume or to understand that it will throw an exception when we pass 0. Right? Here again, unit test would allow you to figure out these scenarios. Right? So this is again, so basically to make this test case pass, what we need to do is add the exception. And now it should pass. Right? So the main takeaway here, even if the piece of code is written by you, there are scenarios or there are corner cases which you yourself would not have anticipated, right? And unless and until you do unit test, it becomes extremely difficult for you to figure out these corner cases, right? So what we had was a very simple class, right? But even then, it had different code flows in it, which we would not have anticipated if we have not had unit test, right? So that is the main takeaway which I want to give for this talk. And okay, before we move on to mocks, again, any questions for what we have seen so far? Okay, infinite loop is something which is very difficult to test because the PHP unit is also going to be running on the PHP process, right? It's not like it's a separate process, so it will just keep on running, it will not return. You would either run out of memory or like run out of stack. So that is something which you cannot do by unit testing. But there are certain static code analyzers. Basically what it can do is like take your source code, analyze it, and then tell you that, hey, this looks like an infinite loop, or this looks as a potential problem and things like that. So you can
use that, but that is not something which you can solve by doing unit testing. And same thing like performance testing. Right? So these need to be in a separate process. But here it runs as part of the same process. Right? Any other questions or we can move on?
How to handle dependencies?
Okay, that is what mocks are for. I'll be talking about that. So basically, like the test case which you have seen so far, we had only one class, right? We had just only a sample class. What if there is another class which on which this class depends on? So those things we can test using mocks. I'll talk about that. Any other questions on things which you have seen so far? Okay, so now let's talk about mocks, right? So at the beginning of the talk, I told you that for unit testing, you have to concentrate on one particular class, right? Or you have to test one particular functionality. But as I said, what happens if you have dependencies? Let's say if you have two classes, and one of those classes depends on the other one, right? Now, what do you test both the classes simultaneously, or do you test those classes individually? Those are the scenarios which arise. So from a unit testing perspective, you should try to minimize the number of dependencies which you are testing. So in this case, you should try to test each class individually. Right? But now what happens, since you have a dependency, you may want to do something called mocks. Basically what it can do is, if you give a class name, it can take that class, create a mock class out of it, which would have the same public interface, but the functionality inside it is, so basically if you have a class, you will take that class, create all the public methods in that class and replace that with dummy values. Right? So the reason why you do that is, you are not interested in testing whether the dependent class is working fine or not. That you will be doing on that dependent class unit test. But in this unit test, you would only be concentrating whether your class is calling those methods. So for instance, if you are calling the other class's method, right, you would just be testing whether it has the ability to call that method, or it is able to process the return value from that method and things like that. But you would not be testing what that dependent class is doing. Okay? That is one scenario where you would be using mocks. The second scenario is, let's say your code, you have a class, and there's a write method in that, or a persist method. And when you call that method, whatever data you have in the class needs to be persisted to a DB, or needs to be sent to a web service, or those kind of scenarios, right? So those things you don't want to write, you don't want to test by writing to the DB and then reading back and things like that. Because that would be done as part of your functional testing or integration testing. So those kind of things you can test by using mocks. So if you have a method that does that, and another method which depends on that, you would mock this method, which basically create a dummy method which is just the same public interface, and then just make sure that this method is getting called with like whatever parameters it was supposed to be called. So that is something for which you would be using mock. As I said, the other functionality is like when you interact with external services. For instance, you are, let's say, calling Twitter's API. You don't want to write your test cases for Twitter's API. Right? All you need to assume is whether your method is able to call the Twitter's API method with like all the parameters in proper order, in proper validation, and things like that. Okay. Also, as I said, if your functionality depends on your class internals or your private methods, then you can mock them and then create test them using your mocks. So these are some personal tips which I have got after like using PHPUnit for quite a while, right? So first and very important thing is to have a test suite which runs very fast. The reason being, it's not a technical reason, but it's a non-technical or purely non-technical reason. The reason is, if you have a unit test suite for your class, let's say it takes 15 minutes to run, you would not be running it on every save, right? So typically what people do is, they would have something like a grunt watch or whatever. So basically, like anytime this file is changed, these test cases are automatically executed, and then it gives you feedback, right?
Now, if you have your test suite which takes like really long time, then you would not run it on every seat. You would probably want to run it like at the end of the day or once a week kind of thing. So it's purely for that non-technical reason, I'm suggesting that you should have a test suite which is as fast as possible. That means, as I initially showed you in the PHP config file, right? Run the test cases only for whatever class which you are currently working on. Don't run the test cases for other class unless until it is dependent on things, right? Because that would make sure that you always, as a developer, you would always have the tendency to run your unit test cases. Because the value you're going to get out of unit test cases depends on how frequently you run it, right? So there is no point you write a class, you test everything, and then try unit test cases. Because you're going to be spending more time, and you're not going to get maximum value out of it. So that's like one major important thing you should keep in mind as a developer. Then the second thing is like, try to use continuous integration. How many of you know what is continuous integration? How many of you use it? Great. So the people who don't know what is continuous integration, the idea is you would try to do testing automated. So every time there is a check-in by anybody or any developer in your team, the test cases automatically run, the build is built automatically, and if it needs to be deployed, it is deployed to a stage environment automatically. All of these things would happen automatically, and it's not that you have to go run some commands to deploy and staging to do your testing and things like that. So these days what people do is, anytime you check into a particular branch in Git, it automatically, they'll set it up such that it automatically deploys, runs the test cases, and emails to the entire group, or like sends some notification to the entire team that something broke and things like that. That kind of cultivates the habit where you would start testing as early as possible. As soon as the code is checked in, there is testing is being done, right? So make sure that if you're not doing unit testing already, if you're not doing continuous integration already, see if you can convince your project managers to take that. Because the amount of time you're going to be putting that, you're going to get extremely huge return of value for that, right? Then the third thing is use Composer. I told about Composer at the beginning of my talk. It's a package manager for PHP which handles all dependencies. So if you're not using Composer and if you're a PHP developer, start using Composer right away. Right? Then the other thing is, there is also something called code coverage which you can do when you are running test cases. Okay. I'll briefly show you that. So basically, like till now we have been running PHPUnit as the command, right? Instead of PHPUnit, if you run this command which basically says hyphen coverage HTML, it will create a code coverage report for your code. So let's go comment out some test cases, basically like show how this thing works. So now I have only one test case for my method, and I'm going to be running this. So that one test case has passed, but it has also created me a code coverage report. So in my folder, if I open that, so it basically creates a set of HTML files which I can open in my browser to see how the code coverage is happening. Right. So basically it's going to show you in your project like how many files you have and what is the code coverage for each of those files. Right. For instance, here we have the sample PHP file and it has an 80% code coverage, and if you click on it, it will also tell you exactly which line is getting covered and which line is not getting covered. Right? If you hover over a particular line, it will tell you like what are the test cases that test that particular line. Right? Here you can see that we are not testing this particular line. Line number 11 is not getting tested because we don't have corresponding test cases. And it will also tell you like each method, what is the code coverage for those methods. For instance, here the initialized method is covered 100% time. So basically like 100% of all the lines in that particular method are unit tested. So you'll get like lot of these metrics about your code. If you have a really huge project, you can get a really extensive report on how things are working on your project. Let me quickly enable all the
test cases and then rerun this. Now when I refresh, you can see that I have 100% code coverage on my class. All my methods are 100% covered and things like that. Right? So this is extremely valuable if you have this. Okay, this is basically when I run PHPUnit with the code coverage option, it basically creates me a folder. So it has basically created a folder, right? Inside that folder, it has a lot of HTML. So I'm just opening the index HTML. And this is like a local file which I've opened. In my browser, I've just opened that local HTML. Okay. So this is like this. So again, like if you hover over this particular line, it shows you that these test cases are covering that. So you can like generate reports like this and figure out like if there are any specific condition or any specific code flow in your code which you're not getting covered in unit test cases and things like that. Okay. To get this thing done, all you need to do is like add this option to your PHP command. Basically, you need to just enable code coverage and then specify the folder where it should be created. So, as I said, enable code coverage, that will give you a lot of good reports. You can even convince your project manager or team leads with that. They would really love to see how testing is getting covered for your code and things like that. Then the other important thing is, you know, when I initially showed you the PHPUnit file, right? I said phpunit.xml and I used so here I've used phpunit.xml.dist, right? So there is a difference between phpunit.xml and phpunit.xml.dist. The reason is this: if you're working in a distributed team, right? Like if there are more than one person in your team, and each person is working on a particular specific functionality. I told you that in your phpunit file, phpunit.xml file, you can in the config file you can create different test suits and make sure that those test cases run really fast. Right? So in that case, what you would have done is like you would have enabled only the class which you are working on. But this phpunit file will be checked into your version control system. And every developer, when he's checked out, would have modified that. Make sure that only his test cases are running on his system locally. Now what happens is, every time you do a git status or sken status, that file will show as modified. You cannot add that file to your git ignore because you need to check it back in. So to avoid that confusion, what you can do is phpunit supports something called .dist. Right? So if in a particular folder, if we have both phpunit.xml.dist and phpunit.xml, then the XML file will take preference. Right? What people do is like they will have the dist file created, that is for the entire team, that is checked into your version control system, and in your git ignore, you can ignore the XML file or the local config file which you have. Okay? So see if you can make use of that. That would, again, as I said, that comes to the first point, right? It will allow you to have the test case run faster, which would again motivate you to run more testing, right? And also, in the sample, I showed you about the assert inputs. Right? There are a lot of other additional assert methods which are available in PHPUnit. I think there are more than around 50 assert methods which are available. Use the assertion which is very specific for you. For instance, if you are just comparing two numbers, then you may use assert inputs. But if you are comparing array values, or if you just compare whether a particular key exists in an array, so there are like different assertion methods which are available. Make sure you use that specific assertion method as possible. Okay? Because that would enable you to have much more stricter validation. Alright. So those are the things which I had. Hopefully, like if you're not doing test cases, just not doing unit testing,
Just try to do it for your next project. It would be really helpful. Yes.
Do we have a login facility?
Sorry, not immediately.
Let's say I have another market or another thing or something like that. So will take more time to run.
Yes.
So is there a login facility instead of seeing
Okay, so what you can have is like you can have here I was running it on my local machine, right? You can have a centralized build, a server, where you can run all these test cases and then generate the reports and then see those reports. So that's basically, that can be done as part of continuous integration.
No, without continuous integration.
Okay.
With the PHP unit support, I'm not going to do continuous integration. It will take a long time.
Yeah, so you can PHP unit per se does not support logging, but you can have a wrapper on top of it which can allow you to.